Good morning, everyone. Whether you're joining us at home or joining us here, we're so happy that you're here today. One of the bigger things that we have learned during this time of quarantining is that we need community. We need people to come together, and we've had to do that distance the past couple weeks, but we're so happy that we can start seeing faces and get to shake hands or elbows with each other. And so thank you all for being there. Please join us in worship.
Down for When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, yeah. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no wall you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Good morning. As we come to this table, and I knew I was going to do this, if you've ever read in John chapter 17, how Christ prays for us. He prayed for us before he went to the cross. He went to that cross knowing what he was going to endure. And sometimes I think about that and it's like, wow, what kind of love is that? That you knew what it was going to mean to go to that cross. The pain that he endured for us. That anyone could love us so much. As parents, yes, we would give our life for our child if it was in a circumstance where we could push them away and take their place. That's what Christ did for us. Our Heavenly Father sent his only begotten Son for us so that he could pray for us, and he is there at the right hand of the Father praying for us every day, just like we pray for our children. He prays for us when he sees us messing up. He prays for us to have strength and endure. He prays for us when he sees us mourning the loss of loved ones. He is always there praying for us, and it just amazes me when you read the prayers to the Father that God has, you know, chosen us. Therefore, we were given to Jesus, and we all still belong to him for all eternity. How much love is that? To this day, I just still can't wrap my head around it. Probably the passion of the Christ brings it closest to anything that we could imagine that he endured. But I think it's his unconditional love that we really struggle with, that he could love us that much. So on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. He broke it, and he gave thanks. And he said, "Eat, this is of my body." Then he took the cup, and he poured it out to his disciples. And he said, "Drink of this, all of you, for the New Testament. For this is my blood poured out for many. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the unimaginable love that you have for us, for the sacrifice that you made for us, Lord. And God, there are no words that can express how grateful we are to be so loved unconditionally, covered by your righteousness, welcomed into your family, Lord. To you be the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
In your house I sit, in awe of who you are. Why would you take someone like me and all the folly disregard? You've shown your endless mercy on the lamb that's gone astray. And that's why I love you, and that's why I serve you, my faithful God. The mention of your name, the blind receive your sight, the deaf can hear your voice, and all the darkness becomes light, and all creation saved because you gave your life. And that's why I love you, and that's why I serve you, my faithful God. Faithful God, mercy without measure, by your grace I see that you are. Faithful God, your patient love I treasure, you have made my heart and that's why I love you, that's why I serve you, my faithful God. On a hill you sent your only son to die. As he turned his head in pain, you turned your head and cried. And that's why I serve you, my faithful God. Faithful God, mercy without measure, by your grace I see that you why I serve you, my faithful God. have made my heart believe. And that's why I love you. That's why I serve you, my faithful God.
Good morning. It's getting fuller. I'm starting to like it a little better each week. It seems to happen frequently that children from good families go bad. We hear of the son of a former government official who dies from a drug overdose, or the son of a Christian family is charged with attempted murder, or the daughter of a well-known Christian author is married for the fifth time. Or how many times have you heard of rotten preacher's kids? Y'all have never heard of those, I know that, because you don't have any here. But there was an article in the Wall Street Journal that suggested that there's an often repeated cycle in American families from striving to affluence to decline in three generations. The first generation is ambitious. The second generation is wealthy. And the third generation is indulgent. That same cycle frequently happens spiritually as Christian families go from commitment to serving to backsliding in three generations. It seems that we Christian parents often fail to communicate our faith to our children. If your parents knew the Lord and you grew up in a solid Christian home, and right now you have a solid Christian home and your children are growing up to know the Lord, you're rare. That's unusual today. And our society needs you as a model of spiritual stability. I think one of our greatest needs as Christian parents is to learn how to transfer our submission to Christ to our children. We all need teachable spirits about this matter. 3 weeks ago, we started a series on the family talking about the first marriage. But today I want to talk about those who are parents. I want to talk about training your children to be submissive to the Lord. I would like for us to take a few minutes and visit the home of an Old Testament character named Eli. Eli was a man of God who did not have much success in transferring his spirituality to his sons. Tragically, he witnessed the disintegration of his home. I'm hoping that we can learn some positive lessons from a pretty negative example. The Bible doesn't tell us anything about Eli's wife, the mother of the home, but we do learn about Eli, who was a priest and a judge. It was not unusual in those days for a man to hold both of those positions. So Eli was busy. He was respected. He had an important position. And he was faithful in that position. The Bible says that Eli had led Israel for 40 years. So Eli was not a restless man. He stayed at it. He was diligent for four decades, and he was a believer in God. As a priest, Eli represented God to the people. Eli's name means Jehovah is high. He was spiritually perceptive. Remember when Samuel was staying at the tabernacle and he heard the voice of God in the middle of the night? He thought it was Eli talking. So he went to Eli and asked him if he had called. And after the third time, Eli said, "When you go back in to lie down, the next time the voice calls, you say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant hears.'" Even though those conversations were very rare, Eli was spiritually perceptive. He wasn't a renegade priest. He wasn't running wild in carnal pursuits. Eli was a discerning man. One other thing about Eli in 1 Samuel 4, verse 18, where it tells about how he died at the age of 98. Listen to this. When he mentioned the ark of God, Eli fell backward off his chair by the side of the gate. His neck was broken and he died, for he was an old man and he was heavy. Now, the Bible doesn't talk very much about people's physiques because God's is not as interested in the outward appearance nearly as much as he is the heart. But every verse of Scripture is there for a purpose. And if the Bible says that Eli was fat, it says that for a purpose. So keep that in mind for later. Eli had two sons named Hophni and Phinehas who didn't share their father's faith. They were also priests, but the priesthood in that day was an inherited position. It wasn't a calling. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 2, verse 12, that Eli's sons were scoundrels. They had no regard for the Lord. There have always been false prophets. There have always been unsaved preachers. Hophni and Phinehas were priests, but they were very corrupt men. The Bible gives a couple examples of their immorality. For example, they exploited the sacrifice at the tabernacle. The Old Testament required that when people offered a meat sacrifice to God, it was permissible for the priest to thrust a three-pronged fork into the boiling pot, and whatever meat they were able to come up with on that one stab, they could keep for their family. That was one of the ways that God provided for the priests. And the understanding was that this was to be done when the meat was boiled. The well-done beef would fall off the fork, so the portions would be limited. But Hophni and Phinehas were chow hounds. They would go after the meat that had just been put into the pot. Verse 15 says, "But even before the fat was burned, the priest's servants would come and say to the person who was sacrificing, 'Give the priest some meat to roast. He won't accept boiled meat from you, but only raw.'" You see, the raw meat will not fall off the bone. They could stick that three-pronged fork into the pot and pull out a huge chunk of beef. Think about a pot roast when you put it in the crock pot. When you put it in there very first thing, you can stab it and pull the whole thing out. You come back 6 or 8 hours later, you'll be lucky to get anything on the fork. See, the sons were rebellious and presumptuous. If the person said to him, "Let the fat be burned first and then take whatever you want," the servant would answer, "No, hand it over now. If you don't, I'll take it by force." And then verse 17 tells us, "The sin of the young men was very great in the Lord's sight, for they were treating the Lord's offering with contempt." Anytime you get too familiar with the sacred, you're on dangerous ground. Hophni and Phinehas had no sensitivity for spiritual matters. They not only exploited the sacrifice, they flaunted immorality. Look at verse 22. "Now Eli, who was very old, heard about everything his sons were doing to all Israel, and how they slept with the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting." In other words, they engaged in illicit activities right in the shadow of the Lord's house. They were living in immorality and flaunting it. They didn't care who knew. They were kind of like couples in the church today who live together, and they're really not bothered about it. They announce it to the world, and there's no sense of wrongdoing. Eli, the father, asked them, "If one person sins against another, God may mediate for the offender. But if anyone sins against the Lord, who will intercede for them?" His sons, however, did not listen to their father's rebuke, for it was the Lord's will to put them to death. Hophni and Phinehas were just too cool. They didn't need the old man's advice. But the Bible says, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows." And eventually, God's judgment came down on Hophni and Phinehas. They both died a shameful death. A.W. Tozer said, "The wheels of God's justice grind slowly, but they grind exceedingly fine." There's one other member of the family you need to meet. We've mentioned him already. And that's sort of an adopted son named Samuel. The young mother Hannah promised God that if he gave her a son, she would take the son to the tabernacle and dedicate him to the Lord. When Samuel was very young, Hannah brought him to the tabernacle and she left him with Eli. Now that took faith, because Hannah left Samuel with a father that was losing touch and whose sons were already in rebellion. It was a foster home that was far from perfect. But the amazing thing is that Samuel grew up in that environment to be a great man of God. He became like a fragrant rose growing up by a cesspool. And verse 26 says, "The boy Samuel continued to grow in stature and in favor with the Lord and with people." If you go to chapter 3, verse 20, it says, "And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord." Now I want to take a moment to hear and just say a few words to the young people here. Maybe your parents aren't perfect. Maybe your parents are divorced or you don't live in the ideal environment of home. That's no excuse for you to stray completely from the Lord. Samuel and thousands just like him have risen above that and become godly people. Now, there's four lessons that I would like for us, especially the parents, to learn this morning. The first lesson is, spirituality is not inherited. It must be transferred. Don't assume that just because you respect biblical values and you love the Lord, that your children are automatically going to follow. Your example is the single most important factor in the development of your child, but there must be more. The era in which we live demands that we be actively involved in training and disciplining and correcting our children. The Bible says to train up that child in the way he should go. There must be an active involvement. There was a daycare that I recently read about that allowed the boys and the girls to use the same bathroom at the same time. A family was told of this by their child, and they approached the director of the daycare center. And the director just casually replied, "Oh yeah, we feel that that's a healthy part of the child's education, and our counselor agrees." I couldn't hardly believe what I was reading. What an infringement that is on the rights of the parents. And this happened in the fairly conservative state of Kentucky. The point is, your children are going to be influenced by worldly standards from the time that they're very small. They'll be influenced by the daycare or cartoons on television or meeting their peers at school. Our moral values in this society are changing so rapidly that if you hold to biblical values, you're part of a moral minority today. That means that we can't sit back passively and hope that our children are going to catch on just by observation. God has no grandchildren. Did you know that? God doesn't have any grandchildren, only children. Our biggest assignment as Christian parents is to somehow transfer our faith to our children. It won't happen automatically. It's not inherited. It wasn't for Eli, and it's not for us. The second thing for us to see is that parents cannot be naive. They must be observant. It might be a little strong, but you could say that parents must be suspicious. You see, these things in our text this morning were going on, and everybody could see it except Eli. If he did know about it, he just closed his eyes and didn't want to see it. He pretended that everything was okay. We do that all the time. Our teenagers say, "Mom or Dad, I want to go out with some friends." And we say, "Well, have a good time." They come back 4 hours later. We don't know where they've been. We ask and they say, "Oh, we went to a movie." "Did you have a good time?" "Yeah." "Movie pretty good?" "Yeah." And if we ask the title, we don't pay any attention to the rating or what goes on in the movie. We don't pay attention to what factors are influencing our child. We just assume that everything's okay. A man of God came to Eli, and in verse 29 he says, "Why do you scorn my sacrifice and offering that I prescribed for my dwelling? Why do you honor your sons more than me by fattening yourselves on the choice parts of every offering made by my people Israel? Why do you, Eli, personally fatten yourselves," plural. You see, Eli was eating the meat that the sons were taking wrongly out of the pot. In his mind, he might have been rationalizing, saying, "Oh, it's not that bad, it's only meat." Or maybe he just wasn't asking the right question. Where did this meat come from? Eli just didn't face the problem. Parents, sometimes instead of setting the moral tone of the home, we just kind of ignore it. Or we adjust our standards in order to accommodate the children or to keep peace. We wink at the little white lie of the child. Or when they use a four-letter word, we think it's cute because they're so little. But let me get more specific and maybe a little more unpopular. Or somebody told me the other day, "Boy, you really stepped in it this week." Let me warn you against smiling at suggestive clothing styles in your children and telling them that it's sexy or cute. Let me caution you about taking your child to plays and entertainment spots just to give them an exposure to the world because you're on vacation. Let me warn you, parents, against giving your teenage children permission to drink in the home because, after all, it's a wedding reception or it's New Year's Eve. I warn you against sitting and watching passively programs on television that are going to affect the moral values of other people and assume that it won't affect your kids. And I caution you against buying a subscription to movie channels on television that you know are bringing the world's values right into your living room and telling your kids, if it gets too raunchy, we'll turn it off. You're not there all the time. And regardless of what they tell you, they're watching. I did. Mom and Dad, we're going to get fat on the world's diet, right along with our kids, and see nothing wrong with it. I warn you against rationalizing your children's behavior by saying, boys will be boys. Everybody has to sow their wild oats. Or how can I discipline them for that? Because I did it when I was their age. A young boy brought his report card to his dad and he said, here's my report card and one of yours in the attic with the same grades on it. The dad said, good, and you'll get the same discipline that I got. You see, erosion takes place quietly and gradually. And if we're blind to it and we rationalize it, we're participating in the problem. Proverbs 19:18 says, discipline your children, for in that there is hope. Do not be a willing party to their death. And that's particularly hard for those who are single parents. That's possibly the toughest job in the world because you have to double your effort. The third lesson is warnings should not be ignored. We must pay attention to others. At least three times, Eli was warned about his son's behavior. The people warned him, the man of God warned him, and God warned him. God appeared to young Samuel, who said, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. And the Lord said to Samuel, see, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears about it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family from beginning to end. For I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. His sons blasphemed God, and he failed to restrain them. Therefore, I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of Eli's house will never be atoned for by sacrifice or offering. When Samuel heard that message, he couldn't go back to sleep. But the next morning, he had the courage to convey it to Eli. And Eli still ignored the warning. Parents, we all have blind spots. God uses other people sometimes to show us what's wrong. Maybe he gives a message from the teachers at school, or the policeman in the community, or another child in the family. And when parents hear that, we have to be discerning. We can't assume the worst. Sometimes people are overstepping their bounds and they don't know. But don't be blind either. Don't be so defensive. Don't be too proud to listen. Don't immediately attack the person talking to you saying, you never have liked my child, or who do you think you are? Respond well to the danger signal. That person may be on your side and is God's agent at that time. And the fourth lesson from Eli is, rebellion cannot be tolerated, it must be confronted. We should confront rebellion early. When the report came back from the people that his sons were wicked, Eli just gave a slap of the hand to his sons. It was an insufficient rebuke. He just said, why are you doing these things? And they didn't pay any attention. When Samuel came up with a warning from God, Eli just accepted it. And he said, well, he's the Lord. Let him do what's good in his eyes. Maybe the Lord can do something with him. I sure can't. Some of you may feel sorry for Eli and think he was just an old man whose kids were rebellious and he probably couldn't do anything anyway. But let me read to you an unusual passage in Deuteronomy 21. This is what the Jewish people were to do with rebellious children. If someone has a stubborn and rebellious son who does not obey his father and mother and will not listen to them when they discipline him, his father and mother shall take hold of him and bring him to the elders at the gate of his town. They shall say to the elders, this son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey us. He is a glutton and a drunkard. Then all the men of his town are to stone him to death. You must purge the evil from among you. All Israel will hear of it and be afraid. Now that's pretty severe, don't you think? There's no biblical record of that ever being carried out. But I guarantee you it was frequently used as leverage by parents. If you don't straighten up, we're going to take you to the city elders, and you know what they're going to do. But Eli doesn't use that leverage. He doesn't threaten to take them to the elders. He doesn't go to the elders and ask them to straighten those boys out. He just lets them go and says, let the Lord do whatever he wants with them. And the Lord will deal with them, but it'll be too late. Parents, one of our greatest assignment is to love our children. If you don't love them, nothing else really matters. Now, I know that our culture today is talking about child abuse, but there's another side to that coin. It's your assignment from God to develop a submissive spirit in your child. If your child does not learn to respect your authority, that child is going to have a difficult time ever submitting to the authority of God. So be perceptive and spot rebellion early. It'll surface again and again, but the longer you wait to confront it, the more difficult it'll be to handle. That means when your two-year-old stomps his foot and throws a temper tantrum, even in the middle of the grocery store, you don't try to patch it over, you deal with it. You teach them that there's a cause and effect principle. You reap what you sow. James Dobson tells of his 4-year-old son acting up in a restaurant. He'd warned the child several times, but the child just wasn't paying any attention. Not wanting to spank him in front of everybody, Dobson took the boy out to the car. As he was getting ready to spank the child, a liberal-thinking woman who had followed them out of the restaurant said, "Unhand that child, you beast! Don't you beat that child!" When the woman said this, the boy quit crying long enough to ask, "Dad, what's wrong with her?" You see, kids know that rebellion needs to be handled. That means when your 10-year-old child begins to snarl and mumble under his breath and talk back, you stop it right there. That's not tolerated here. If it continues, when you come home from school tomorrow, there'll be no TV and no video games. Or when your teenager disagrees and storms to the room and slams the door, you don't just sit back passively and say, "Well, kids are kids. I guess they'll grow out of it." It may get better later, but more likely they'll grow more and more defiant. Maybe they're too big to spank, but they may have their driver's license and want the car for the weekend. Love sometimes has to be tough. But the most important thing from all of these lessons is that when we take that stand, we continue to love. Some parents have older teenagers, and you may feel that you've lost them. You can't go in like a stormtrooper, but you can sit down in a quiet moment with the family and say, "Look, we've made some mistakes, but there's some guidelines, the new guidelines that are going to take effect right now. Here are a few basic standards, and here's the consequences." And then you follow through. If you tell them they can't have the car for a week, don't let them have the car for a week, no matter how inconvenient it is. No matter how foolish it looks when you chaperone your son on his date to the drive-in movie. Follow through, but do it all in love. Be the kind of parent who disciplines consistently, leverages information effectively, but also knows how to hug and love your children. Mom and dad have been given a big assignment, but work at bringing that child to a point where you can say, "They're yours, Lord." And may the kids say, "Not my will, but yours, Lord, be done." If you've not said that in your own life, we offer you an invitation this morning to do exactly that, to submit your life to the Lord. If you'll obey him as your Father, he wants to grant to you eternal life. And he wants you to share the good news of salvation with others, especially your children. Won't you come to him in submission this morning in repentance as we stand and sing? Just a couple real quick announcements this morning. Come on up, Jamie. The outreach ministry is doing a couple different things. One thing they're going to do is they're collecting funds for what's called a tippy tap. We'll try to have some pictures for it next week. And what it is, and these are going to go to Guatemala. It's a plastic jug and string and sticks, a plastic jug and soap. And that's what they make this tippy tap out of it. It's a way to wash your hands, you know, for cleanliness in these countries. And the stick actually tips the jar, the plastic jug over. They take soap, wash their hands. Everything's right there contained. And it's specifically designed for areas that don't have water wells and a lot of fresh water. But it's a way that they can, you know, for sanitary reasons, be more healthy in their communities. They're $12?
$12.50
for each tippy tap to make. So you can see Lindsay about that later if you want. We'll try to have more information to announce next week about that as well. The missions fund is actually going to match whatever is given for those tippy taps. So if we raise $100, that'll be $200. If we raise $1,000, that'll be $2,000 for these tippy taps. And there's a contact that we have with someone in Guatemala that's going to make sure that this is done. It's a really, really cool project for them to do. Also on June 24th, they're going to have sort of a feed. That's that Wednesday, which will be our normal fellowship meal. There's a sign-up sheet out in the foyer. It's going to be either drive-through or delivery, like a lot of our restaurants are doing, but just kind of a way to get people back engaged in that for when we can start meeting again here to do that as a church. Is that it? Oh, the menu for that night is meatloaf, mashed potatoes and gravy, green beans, salad, rolling as dessert. So let us know if you want a meal that night. No charge. I'll take three. Okay. Very good. Right. Yep. Yeah, but lots of volunteers will be needed for sure. Okay. I think that's everything we have. We'll have Jamie close us in prayer.
How's everybody doing this morning? I had all these thoughts in my mind for a prayer, and then Mike said, meatloaf, mashed potatoes. She gone. It's good to see everybody this morning. I'd like to say hello to everybody that's tuned in on Facebook as well that couldn't be here. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, how grateful we are that we can yet again meet in your house as a family. We're so thankful through everything that we've been through that we can still come together. We're so thankful that we can reach so many more people on Facebook and deliver your word to those who can't be here. Thank you so much for just being our Father, for always being there, for answering our prayers. I'm thankful for this great nation that we live in and the freedoms that we have. It's really something to see groups of people all over the nation rise up to demonstrate for a specific cause. I'm just so sorry that the actions of a few bad seeds spoil it for everyone. I pray that we could remove the filters from our eyes, Father, and we could see each other for what we are, your children, your creation, brothers and sisters with one Heavenly Father. I'm most thankful of all for the gift of your word and the freedom that we have to preach it freely in this nation. I just wish we wouldn't squander that opportunity so much. Father, I pray and I would give anything to see the people come together like they have been for you, to preach your word, to praise you, to love you, and to love one another. Father, I pray that it would happen in my lifetime. I would love to be a part of it. I'd love to see it. But most of all, I just pray for it in your time. Once again, I'm so thankful for my church family. I like to pray for those who can't be here, for those who are fighting illness right now, those who are in the hospital, suffering the consequences of the social distancing, who can't have visitors, and how hard it must be on them. I pray that we can reach out to our brothers and sisters that can't be here, that we can talk to them, that we can let them know that we're always going to be here and we're here for them. Most of all, Father, I thank you for your Son. I thank you for coming to this world so many years ago to bear the burden of the sin of all mankind, that we can have that eternal relationship with you, Father. And it's in his holy name I pray. Amen.